hello. Welcome to 1 Billion Rising. If you've just come into the cafeteria, I hope that you'll remain. We have a little bit more of the program. And maybe at the end we can do this dance again and get more of the audience up. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the plan and give you some background. First of all, my name is Ann Wiley. I'm professor of psychology and gender and women's studies. And I have not danced like that since I was about 15, so I'm a little worn out. So let me give you some background. 15 years ago, Eve Ensler wrote the Vagina Monologues. These monologues were based on interviews with over 200 women and girls around the world. She envisioned that everyday people in communities, colleges, schools, homes, and groups could read the monologues, not perform them, but read them, and raise awareness about violence against women and girls, as well as raise money for violence prevention programs. GCC performed these monologues for 6 years and raised money for our own Women's Resource Center and our agency, NELQUIT. We have both of those represented at these tables here. Today, 15 years later, Eve Ensler has set up and challenged around the world 1 Billion Rising. If you have not gone to the website today, www.1billionrising.org, I really urge you to do it. There are girls and women and men and boys dancing in almost every country around the world to stop and prevent violence. So you have witnessed just now a reclamation of women's bodies in the strike dance Rise, a dance that was choreographed by Debbie Allen. Those of you who are old enough know she's the choreographer of fame. So let us give another round of applause for those fabulous dancers. And I really do hope at the end we can all get up and dance again. For the next 20 minutes or so, we're going to share some readings with you, and then we're going to challenge you to make a pledge to stop violence against women and girls. There will be orange sheets on your tables and small purple sheets that will give you the statistics of violence in Massachusetts. So the readings are going to be done by Christine Monahan, Rosemarie Freeland, and Cheryl Rogers. So if I could first have Christine Monahan, and she is going to be reading I Cannot Remember All the Times.
Hi. If there's any of my former English 112 students in here, you should remember this poem, but there won't be a quiz. I cannot remember all the times. I cannot remember all the times he hit me. I might could count black eyes, how many times I said I ran into doors, or fell down, or stepped into the path of a flying object except his fist. Once I got a black eye playing softball. The rest were him. 7, 8. I can name what of me he broke. My nose, my arm, and 4 ribs in the course of 6 years marriage. The ribs were after I said divorce. And in spite of a peace bond, I spent the night in the hospital. He did not even spend a night in jail. The sheriff I helped elect does not apply the law to family business. He always swore he never meant to do it. I do believe he never planned. It was always just the day, the way I looked at him, afraid. Maybe the first time he did not mean to do it. Maybe the broken ribs were for good luck. I want to post this in ladies' rooms. Write it on the tags of women's underwear. Write it on coupons to go in Tampax packages. Because my ex-husband will want to marry again. And there is no tattoo where he can't see it to tell the next woman who might fall in love with him. After 6 months, maybe a year, he will start with a slap you can brush off. Leave when he slaps you. When he begins to call you cunt and whore and threatens to kill you if you try to go, it will almost be like teasing, but it's not. Keep 2 sets of car keys for yourself. Take your children with you when you go. If he is throwing things, he is drinking. If he is drunk enough, he cannot catch you. A punch in the breast hurts worse than a punch in the jaw. A hit with an object does more damage than a hit with a fist, unless he's so drunk he picks up a broom instead of a poker. If you pick up the poker, he will try to get it. If he gets it, he will hit you with it. He probably will not kill you because you will pass out, and then he is all of a sudden sorry, and he stops. When he says he will not hit you again as he drives you to the hospital, both of you in tears and you in pain, you have stayed much too long already. Tell the people at the hospital the truth. No matter how much you think you love him, do not say you fell down the stairs. No matter how much he swears he loves you, he does love you. He loves you hurt, and he will hit you again.
So now Rosemarie Freeland, the coordinator of the Women's Resource Center here at GCC, will read, "I Was There in the Room," from one of the first original vagina monologues.
I was there when her vagina opened. We were all there, her mother, her husband, and I, and the nurse from the Ukraine with her whole hand up there in her vagina, feeling and turning with her rubber glove as she talked casually to us, like she was turning on a loaded faucet. I was there in the room when the contractions made her crawl on all fours, made unfamiliar moans leak out of her pores, and still there, after hours, when she just screamed suddenly, wild, her arms striking at the electric air. I was there when her vagina changed from a shy sexual hole to an archaeological tunnel, a sacred vessel, a Venetian canal, a deep well with a tiny stuck child inside waiting to be rescued. I saw the colors of her vagina. They changed. Saw the bruised, broken blue, the blistering tomato red, the gray pink, the dark. Saw the blood like perspiration along the edges. Saw the yellow, white liquid, the shit, the clots, pushing out all the holes, pushing harder and harder. Saw through the hole the baby's head, scratches of black hair. Saw it just there behind the bone. A hard, round memory. As the nurse from the Ukraine kept turning and turning her slippery hand. I was there when each of us, her mother and I, held a leg and spread her wide, pushing with all our strength against her pushing, and her husband sternly counting 1, 2, 3, telling her to focus harder. We looked into her then. We couldn't get our eyes out of that place. We forget the vagina, all of us. What else would explain our lack of awe, our lack of reverence? I was there when the doctor reached in with his Alice in Wonderland spoons, and there as her vagina became a wide operatic mouth, singing with all its strength, first the little head, then the gray flopping arm, then the fast swimming body, swimming quickly into our weeping arms. I was there later when I just turned and faced her vagina. I stood and let myself see her all spread, completely exposed, mutilated, swollen, and torn, bleeding all over the doctor's hands, who was calmly sewing her there. I stood, and her vagina suddenly became a wide, red, pulsing heart. The heart is capable of sacrifice. So is the vagina. The heart is able to forgive and repair. It can change its shape to let us in. It can expand to let us out. So can the vagina. It can ache for us and stretch for us, die for us, and bleed us into this difficult, wondrous world. I was there in the room. I remember.
So now our last single reading, and then there will be a collective reading, is with Cheryl Rogers, the executive director of Nelquit, and she will read No More by Ashley.
Ashley shares, I wrote this poem depicting my journey and my realization. I could only be a victim as long as I allowed myself to be. And I refuse to be a victim. No More by Ashley. A life that has for so long been controlled by manipulation and fear, so many times left broken and in tears. Broken bones and bruises followed by promises allowed to heal, names and accusations, confusion at the appeal. Was it really appeal or just a distorted view? A victim of the lies, a victim of I don't know what to do. Attempts to do what's right, attempts to inspire change, feelings of defeat when things remain the same. I will be happy. I have the will to stand fear in the face. Determination to finally escape this dreadful place. Emergence out of the darkness, finally able to see the light. Finally, the courage to stand up, to fight this, to fight the fight. No more being afraid, no more running away, no more looking back and living like yesterday. No, I say, no more being afraid, no more excuses. No longer a victim, but a survivor of abuse. By Ashley.
So now we're going to have a collective reading, nine individuals, staff and faculty from Greenfield Community College are going to read the piece Rising that was written this year by Eve Ensler. Eve Ensler wrote, as I mentioned earlier, the first 15 or 20 monologues that are documented in the Vagina Monologues. You can also see an HBO performance that she did about 8 years ago. And this is, she wrote a monologue for each of the 15 years representing different women and violence against different women and girls from all around the world. This particular one is written about, starts with the women of India. Rising, written in Kerala for the women of India who lead the way. This could have been anywhere and was. Mexico City, Manila, Mumbai, Manhattan, nighttime men waiting like wolves, drooling for prey behind the single dimly painted door, paying nothing, a couple of dollars or euros, rubies or pesos, to have her, enter her, eat her, devour her, and throw away her bones.
This could have been anywhere and was. A Buddhist nun on a bus, trying to stay dry for the night. A woman leader speaking out against the repressive government. A young woman traveling with her boyfriend. One lost her voice, the other her following, the last one her life.
This could have been anywhere and was. Pink wooden crosses, a stack of stones, red wilting carnations, empty chairs in a square, ribbons flying in a sultry wind. I ask Anna, Nagat, Kamla, Monique, Tanisha, Emily, why? Why? ¿Por qué eran mujeres? ¿Por qué eran mujeres? Because they were women. Because they were women.
This could have been anywhere, and was. Where she got fired for being too beautiful, fined for drinking after she was raped, a serious offer to marry her rapist, got told it was legitimate but not forcible. This could have been anywhere. They do such a thing when the girls go for firewood, step into the lonely man's car, drink a little too much at the college party, wake up with her uncle's fingers inside, run from the screaming machete and guns, be taken at sunrise, get a bullet in the brain for learning the alphabet, be stoned for falling in love, be burned for seeing the future.
I am done cataloging these horrors. Data porn. 2 million women raped and tortured. One out of three women. A woman raped every minute, every second. One out of two, one out of five, the same one, one, one. I'm done counting and recounting.
It's time to tell a new story. It needs to be our story. It needs to be outrageous and unexpected. It needs to lose control in the middle. It needs to be sexy and in our hips and in our feet.
It needs to be angry and a little scary, the way storms can be scary. It needs to not ask permission or get permits or set up offices or make salaries. It won't be recorded or bought or sold or counted. It needs to just happen. It is not a question of inventing, but remembering. Buried under the leaves of trauma and sorrow, beneath the river of semen and squalor, vaginas and labias, shredded and extracted, stolen. Body minds, mind bodies, it is not about asking now or waiting. It is about rising.
Raise your arm, my sister, my brother. Raise your 1 billion, your one heart, your one with us.
I used to be afraid of love. It hurt too much. What never happened, what got ripped away, the rape, the wound, and love, I thought was salt, but I was wrong. I was wrong.
Step into the fire. Raise your arm. Raise your 1 billion. One, one, one. Rising, rising, rising.
So thank you all. What I'm going to ask you to do, those of you who have the orange sheet on your table, I'm going to read the pledge. I'm hoping that you will join me after I say each phrase, and then we will ask the dancers to come back up, and the line of great dancers from our dance department in the front, and anyone else who wants to dance can be in the behind them or on the sides. Feel free to stand up and dance in your own place. So you can help prevent violence. Educate yourself about violence in your own community. You have the statistics from Massachusetts in purple on your sheet. Take time to teach nonviolent ways of resolving conflict. Educate the men in your life about their responsibility for ending men's violence against women and girls. Create safe environments where youth are valued and encouraged to believe in their potential to be leaders in ending abuse or bullying.
Are you gonna help do the pledge with me?
Yeah.
Okay. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Or should we do one phrase at a time? Okay.
I am one of the 1 billion rising. And I pledge that on 14
February 2013,
I will make violence against women and girls the central issue of our time. And help to end it in my family, school, job, community, city, state, country, by doing the following: going to the website and actually entering your name. So let's have that last phrase. Help to end it in my family,
school, job, community, city, state,
country, by doing the following. Thank you.
Ashe, ashe, ashe. And if you feel like taking this energy forward all day, be aware as you travel through your day and end up in Northampton with the same dance again. Flash mob where you feel like dancing, and along the way, enjoy life.
Thank you. So dancers, come on up.